Okay, hello everyone and welcome to this session of our series on Quranic studies in Indonesia, organized by the International Quranic Studies Association and the Indonesian Organization for the Study of the Quran and Hadith. Today it's my great pleasure to introduce Erwan Nurtawab, who's a lecturer, senior lecturer of Quranic studies at the State Institute of Islamic Studies, EIN, in Metro Lampung. He completed his PhD in anthropology at Monash University just 2 years ago with a thesis on pedagogical practices around tafsir and specifically the Tafsir al-Jalalain in Indonesia. But he's also a very prolific writer and researcher in the field of manuscripts of the Quran, of tafsir and Quran translation in Southeast Asia in a number of local languages. And he has done an impressive amount of work on manuscripts from Sunda, Java, the wider Malay world, even the Philippines. He has also been involved in very important cataloging and digitizing projects. So he's maybe one of the foremost experts or even the foremost experts on tafsir and Quran translation manuscripts in the region. And this is why I'm very excited to have him here. And I'm really looking forward to hearing him talk about the Quran and Javanese complexity and controversies. Please, Erwan, go ahead.
Okay. Hello, everyone. First of all, thank you very much, Professor Johanna Ping, Pak David, Mbak Lin, for this great initiative in organizing serial lectures of the Indonesian scholarship on the Quran. And thanks, everyone, for attending, Pak Ikhwan, Prof. Adnan, and Mas Fadli Lukman, and many others. I'm very glad to see all of you here. This is absolutely wonderful where I can certainly learn much from all of the speakers and many of you and receive feedback and suggestions from everyone regarding the research I'm going to present in today's seminar, which is about the Quran in Javanese, its complexity and controversies. Let me start sharing the screen. Hopefully, work out. Okay. Oops, sorry. Wow, sorry. Okay. The Quran in Javanese refers to all the exegetical and all translation activities in Javanese. Regarding the title of this presentation, I don't say that all Javanese Quran translation or tafsir are complex and controversy. Analysis of what I identify as complex and controversy is in the way we examine the Quran Jawi author by Bagus Ngarpah. Before all, please let me express my grateful thanks to all my colleagues who helped me in so many ways. All the staff of the Yayasan Sastra Lestari in Solo, Pak Pardo, Mas John Peterson, and their crew. They have provided me with the transliterated version of the Ngarpah's Quran Jawi ready for investigations. And also Professor Nico Klapin and my colleague Ahmad Tobari for fruitful discussions. And of course, Mas Adi Deswijaya as my co-researcher and co-author for our forthcoming publication in this subject. And of course, we are very grateful to the staff of the Rakyat Pustaka Museum who gave us in so many ways. Before going further to the elaboration of my presentation about the Quran in Javanese, it is better for me to present the whole picture of the way the research was conducted. As Professor Johanna Ping already said, this is not based on my PhD research project actually, and that is not actually something I met through in 1 year or so. It can be said that this topic represents the whole journey of my academic career as the one who have interest in the study of the Quranic exegetical activities in the Malay, Javanese, and Sundanese cultural regions from the earliest period until the coming of the modernizations. This research started with the composition of my BA thesis in 2003, titled The Treasures of Classical Quranic Commentaries in the Archipelago, the Tradition of Copying Quranic Commentaries and Translations in Javanese and Sundanese Societies After the 19th Century. Here, I analyzed manuscripts and editions kept in the Indonesian National Library at Jakarta and museums in Sumedang, Surakarta, and Yogyakarta, as well as in private collections that in some ways contain Quranic critical activities. And as you can see in the slides, the research project on the Javanese Quran continued in the following years, where I was able to publish some works on related subjects, especially the one published in the Routledge Studies in the Quran in 2016, edited by my colleague and mentors, Dr. Majid Baneshgar, Professor Friedel, and Professor Andrew Ripin. At the time I started undertaking this research, I was fortunate that I was able to consult with two academic works, the first being written by Professor Michael Fina, published in the 1998 Studia Islamica, and the second being authored by Ulenberg in 1964, titled A Critical Survey of Studies on the Languages of on the Languages of Java and Madura. Both Finner and Ulenbeck's works have have inspired me in the way I looked at the Quranic exegetical tradition in the region, especially in Venice. For example, in Professor Finner's publication, he stressed the difference regarding the characteristic of Javanese Quranic tafsir or translation produced in the early past to be compared with later, produced later. Meanwhile, Ulenberg states a great difficulty in tracing the activity of translating the Quran in Java. It was because for him, the data was not completely available compared to us in Bible translation project, because his in his book he tried to make the inventory something. I mean he did the inventory project of the Bibles and the Quran print edition, but he found it difficult to test the printed editions of the Quran compared to those, I mean, compared to the Bible's translations, especially those printed during the 19th century. The Quran in Javanese, as we know, has been developed in three different scripts, that is Javanese script, Javanese Pagan, and Roman script. The first two scripts have their examples of extant writings from as early as 18th and 19th centuries, or can be older. Meanwhile, the Roman script can be found in its later period that coincide with the coming of modernizations. Recently, I have written two forthcoming papers on aspects of translation and the sources used as reference for the compositions of the two Javanese Quran exegesis written in Javanese Pagan and Javanese script. The first, jointly with my colleague Fasjud Sukroni, is on the Quran manuscript that contains Japanese interlinear translation from the 18th century Banten, from the 18th century Banten Quran entitled Quranic Arabic, Tafsir al-Jalalain and Japanese, Japanese translation in 18th century Banten Quran, A54. And thank you very much, Professor Johanna, for reviewing this article. It means a lot for us during the revision process. And the second, jointly with my colleague Adi Deswijaya, comes our attention in today's webinar on it is on the manuscript that contains Japanese translation of the Quran and their interpretive editions entitled Controversies in the Early 20th Century Japanese Quran, First Numbering and Arabic References in Ngarepas Quran Jawi. Going back to my 2016 paper, I already attempted to present the picture of Quranic translation, or to some extent we can identify them as tafsir, Malay, Japanese, and Sundanese cultural regions, considering the ways in which variations in translation types reflects how this works function in Muslim communities as a commentary or substitution. Presented comparatively, it is proven that the Quranic tafsir or translation in Japanese cultural region greatly varied in terms of their production. This exegetical activity flourished or developed long before the 20th century. Some identified works are complete, meaning that they interpret the whole Quran. Some are incomplete, usually found in manuscripts of very mixed content, often with pieces of an Arabic tafsir copied into such works. Furthermore, the aim of making Quranic commentary was not only for comprehension, but probably also for serving a substitute for the Quran itself, as may be seen from some of the 19th and the early 20th century Japanese Quran. As in the next slide, in the following period, the Japanese authors included the original Arabic text of the Quran in their works. Some works, some works usually met earlier tend to exclude the Arabic Quran. Meanwhile, some others that were produced later accommodated more spaces and layout for the Quranic Arabic text to be included. You can see the differences in the examples presented in this slide. This is the 19th century production, and this is the 20th century production, the Samsia publisher. In my opinion, there might be two reasons why some Japanese tafsir editions in its early phase during the 19th to the early 20th century did not include the Arabic text. The first reasons, as in the case of the printed edition by Lang and Co. in 1858, this Batavian company seems not to have the technology for printing Arabic letters. So this is kind of the technical reasons. But the second reason might lie in the fact that, like what Rick Pfeff in 2007 states, there was a widened gap, between the Japanese literature tradition in the aristocrat or palace milieu and the Japanese literature tradition of the countryside. Rickleff referred his opinion to founder his analysis of the 1831 reports issued by the colonial government. In this regard, Rickleff said that This was because devout Muslim believe that man is not capable of understanding any other education until he is completely familiar with the teachings of his faith. So other discipline might be unnecessary. Radcliffe also said that such a gap does not seem to have been a feature of Japanese life in the period before 1830. In the coming decades, Santren would become a much more common feature of the countryside, while the gap between Islamic and Japanese knowledge would widen. In my opinion, Radcliffe's opinion on the statement on the widened gap between Islamic education of the countryside and knowledge of Japanese language and literature is very problematic. And I think this is not entirely correct. Although the lifestyle of Japanese aristocrats were very much Japanese and was and westernized at the time, we can still find some Japanese aristocrats in the 19th and early 20th century. Java had devoted themselves in studying Islam and the Quran. One example is Bagus Ngarpa. There is a little we know about Bagus Ngarpa's life. As long as this research is concerned. But one thing for sure, he was appointed as the teacher of the Manbangul Ulum School and once held the position of the principal of the school. Probably he can be he was probably the first principal because the school was opened for the first time in 1905, and this is the period when he held the position as the principal, if I'm not mistaken. Bagus Ngarpa is identified as the one who has who was responsible for the authorship of many Japanese works, especially in Islamic field or in Islamic studies. But the most important one that had created a dispute and controversy among the Japanese Muslim, even attracted attention from a Sayyid in Batavia, Sayyid Usman, as well as in Singapore, and also attracted attention from the colonial government, is his Japanese translation of the Quran. As for the physical identification of the manuscript used for the purpose of study here, as you can see in the slide, this is the 3 volumes of the manuscript titled Quran Jawi, written by Bagus Ngarpa. He is the early 20th century royal servant in the Japanese Keraton of Surakarta. This manuscript is now held as part of the library collection of the Ratia Pustaka Museum in Surakarta. Considering the fact that this museum has existed since Ngarpa's lifetime period at the turn of the 20th century, it is very likely that since the beginning, the manuscript has been safely kept in this institutions. As you can see in this slide, you can see different inks, the use of different inks here. Black and red inks were used for different purposes. The black one is used to write the main text, that is the translation text, and the chapter heading. And the red ink was used to write the what I identified as the interpretive editions placed in the parentheses. You can see the parentheses written in red ink here. In this slide. In this opportunity, we would like to focus on 2 aspects. First is the Arabic references that Ngarpa used for composition of Quran Jawi. And second, being the first numbering system employed in this work. What we identified as a complex from this work is in the way the author, Bagus Ngarpa, utilized many references, including those that I categorize as non-commentary works, such as dictionaries, language encyclopedia, and books of fiqh. So this is very uncommon actually. In the Quranic exegetical tradition in the Indonesian Malay world. Here, we argue that such a massive use of many references from both Quranic, commentary works and non-commentary ones, was uncommon in the Quranic exegetical activities up to the early 20th century. Even it is still uncommon in the Malay Indonesian world before the period of what Howard Federspiel in 1994 identifies as the emergence of enriched commentaries since the 1970s onward. As presented in this slide, we examine the complexity in the use of Arabic references found in the interpretive editions to the translation text in the Quran Jawi. As I said, Ngarpah interpretive edition in parentheses using red inks, and at the end of the explanation, he shortly mentioned one or more Arabic titles as the reference. In our analysis to follow, some of the listed works clearly refer to the works known among the Javanese pesantren people of the countryside. Some works, especially those categorized as the non-commentary works, seems to be uncommon in use for pedagogical practices in the 19th to the early 20th century pesantren. This is based on the inventory project of Arabic works by Van den Berg. He did the inventory project of Arabic works used and circulated in the late 19th century Javanese pesantren. Our examination toward use of Arabic works for the composition of interpretive editions reveals that Ngarpas, the connection, obviously shows a complexity in use of various references. It is more complex, I think, yeah, it is more complex than the extant commentary manuscript ever known produced in the Malay Indonesian world up to the early 20th century. Some Arabic commentaries like Tafsir al-Baghawi, Tafsir al-Khazin, Tafsir al-Baidawi, and especially Tafsir al-Jalalain show the domination as the reference in the making of the 17th and 19th century Malay Quranic commentaries. From Aceh, for example, with Tarjuman al-Mustafid, studied by Riedel, and one from Mindanao that I analyzed in my publication in 2019, and also the one written in Malay language, which is the internet translations found in the Banten Quran that I also analyzed in my current publication in 2020, as well as the printed Maranao Tafsir from Southern Philippines in 1930. This is based on the analysis made by Professor Kawashima Midori in her publication in 2016. And also the early Japanese translation found in the 18th century Banten Quran, A54, in my forthcoming publication. So all of this extant Malay or Japanese manuscript shows that four tafsir I mentioned, Al-Baghawi, Al-Khazin, Al-Baidawi, and Al-Jalalain, showed their domination as the reference in the making of the Quran commentaries in the Malay Indonesian world. So this is according to Riedel's statement. But based on the table, as you can see in the slide, Ngarpah used the tafsir Jalalain. And then he also used two glosses of the Jalalain, shortly mentioned in Javanese spelling here as Jamal and Sawi. I think this is number 4 and number 12. The work mentioned as Jamal and Sawi, or Sawi here, possibly refer to the Jalalain Glossis authored by Sulaiman bin Umar al-Ujari al-Azhari, title Al-Futuhat al-Ilayyah, known as Hasyat al-Jamal, and second by Ahmad bin Muhammad al-Sawi, title Hasyat al-Sawi ala Tafsir al-Jalalain. Let us go back to the slide about the translation of Surah Al-Fatihah in the Quran Jawi. Here we are going to analyze the interpretive additions provided by Bengarpa as indicated in the red inks. As you can see here in the translated version and its English translations, Ngarpa used Hasyat al-Jamal in many parts of the interpretive editions. One example is his translation of Surah Al-Fatihah here. That shows the domination of this work for providing a definition of keywords Yawmuddin, Day of Judgment, Asyirah al-Mustaqim, the straight path, and Ni'mah from An'amta alayhim. So, if the title Jamal mentioned in the Quran, mentioned in the Quran Jawi here, truly refers to the Hasyat al-Jamal, we find that Ngarpa seems to have read work carefully. He then selected and quoted some key points here and finally presented them with his own expressions. The first example here is the explanation of the place Jawabuddin in agama in the translation of Surat Al-Fatihah here. The presented interpretive edition here partly corresponds to a piece of commentary found in the Hasyat al-Jamal. Because the time concern, I will not go further in detail in presenting the examples. The second is found in the explanation of the word Siratul Mustaqim here, or in Javanese, wordless here. Both additional explanation might be taken from chunks of the commentary of this verse in the Hasyat al-Jamal. The third example comes from the explanation of the word Ni'mah here, and the groups that God has planted them. There's three examples from the presented interpretive edition found in the Quran Jawi are actually generally found in the mainstream Quranic commentaries, of course. But what is found as a resemblance, between those presented in the Quran Jawi and the Hasyat al-Jamal might confirm that Ngarpa seems to have referred to this clause or referred to this Quranic commentary. We go back to slide 9 here. We have identified that some non-Arabic commentaries were used as a references for presenting some interpretive additions. Ngarpa was interested to provide definitions based on Arabic works, based on Arabic works that shortly appeared as Muhtar, Misbah, Khoyatul Hewan in number 6 here, and Takribat number 14 here. In this regard, the use of the non-commentary works shows an interesting fact, where the authors seem to have been obsessed with presenting various information for his targeted audience or targeted readers who might need related information to serve the study of the Quran. Aside from the Arabic dictionaries, Karpa also referred to the Islamic works on Islamic jurisprudence, but we are not analyzing them in detail here, affirming that more investigation on this matter need to be done in the future. Identification in the use of non-commentary works looking like Arabic dictionaries, for me, seems to be very difficult. Because linguistic words seems have been uncommon in use for Islamic pedagogy. Inventory projects, the first being conducted by Van den Berg and other by Bruneisen, and also by us, based on the collections of kitabs kept in the library of the Sophia University in Tokyo during 2010. All of these three projects can be used to determine types of Islamic works that were circulated in the Javanese Pesantrens from the late 19th to the late 20th century Java, assuming that Islamic texts or kitab unlisted in these projects indicate a very limited availability. So what they shortly appeared in Ngarpa's works therefore indicates that non-Arabic commentaries like the dictionary work seems to have been uncommon in use for Islamic education at the turn of the early 20th century Java. If the dictionary works listed in the table are the works that Ngarpa used for the composition of his Quran Jawi, especially the additional explanation parts, we suggest that Ngarpa showed a certain level of criticism in utilizing those references. Maybe he paraphrased selected information, and finally, he presented his own understanding or his own point of view. For Arabic dictionaries here that have short titles, one is found in Ngarpa's work, Mukhtar, Misbah, Hayatul Hewan, and Ta'rifat. For example, the first title, I mean the Mukhtar, seems to be the work of Muhammad bin Abi Bakar bin Abdul Qadir al-Razi, titled Mukhtar al-Sihah. The second dictionary coming out in the Quran Jawi, which is called Misbah here, possibly refers to the Al-Misbah al-Munir fi Gharib al-Shar al-Kabir by Ahmad bin Muhammad bin Ali al-Mukri al-Fayyumi. Compared to Mukhtar, I mean Mukhtar al-Sihah, the use of this work, I mean the use of Misbah is seemingly less frequent than the Mukhtar one. But at least we identified that Ngarpa mentioned this work twice in his translation of in his translation of Surat Al-Baqarah. So he mentioned this work twice in Surat Al-Baqarah. Another dictionary is what Ngarpa shortly mentioned as Hayatul Hewan. We identified this work as the one authored by Ali bin Muhammad al-Jurjani, a title Mujam at-Ta'rifat. It will be as we analyze in our forthcoming paper, the use of this work in Quran Jawi, I mean Mujam at-Ta'rifat, is more frequent than the above dictionary works. As presented in the table as well, Ngarpa was also interested in reference in the field of Islamic jurisprudence, yeah, showing that he seems to have intended to show their practical understanding. Different from the above, the non-commentary works, Arabic references in the field of Islamic jurisprudence, for example, Taqrib and its commentary title Fathul Qarib are very popular in the pesantren milieu. And Ngarpa also mentioned Mizan Sakrani here, Mizan Sakrani number 9, that possibly refers to the work of Abdul Wahab bin Ahmad Asy'arani titled Mizan Al-Mizan Al-Kubro. Also one fresh work in the field of Islamic jurisprudence composed in the late 19th century, Inna at-Talibin, which is spelled in Japanese as Inangatu Talibin or Inganatu Talibin here. This is, of course, this is the one authored by Abu Bakar Usman bin Muhammad Shatta Adim Yati al-Bakri. Now we turn our attention to the discussion on the first numbering system employed in Quran Jawi. Bin Ismail, Yaqub, and Yusuf in 2016, they note the elaborations of the first numbering system is not found in the fields of the mainstream Quranic sciences, which is Ulumul Quran. Their examination of the classical Quranic manuscripts revealed that Quran manuscript scribers, the copier of the scribes of Quran manuscript did not employ numbers included in the first markers up to the 20th century period that coincide with the wide circulation of the Quran printing. The Quran produced before the 20th century generally used circle as the first markers, and that no number was inserted inside. Given that the first numbering system for the Quran is the modern phenomenon, we suggest that the way Ngarbah separated the translated Quranic verses with numbers in Javanese script was a pioneering in the Malay Indonesian world. So in this presentation, we examine the first numbering system used by Ngarbah in the composition of the Quran Jawi. So our identifications shows that the way the translated Quranic verses in Javanese language and script here were numbered in Ngarbah's work is very much different from the mainstream first numbering system, that is the Kufan system and other known numbering system in the Muslim world. In our attempt at setting up a comparative analysis of this aspect, we use the Quaid standard Quran, which is Mushaf Abdullah Al-Quaid, officially stating that the Quran follows the Kufan first numbering system, and also one Quran that follows the Medina one system printed by Al-Mansurah in Egypt. We are very grateful to Farin publication here. Farin in 2019 published his work. He stated that six systems in the Quranic first numbering have been developed since the late first Islamic Hijri or early 8th century, and that the system are named after the places they originated. That is Medina 1, Medina 2, Meccan, Damascus, Kufan, and hymns.
Avon, yeah. Could you yeah. come to your conclusion in the next 5 minutes or so?
Okay. Sorry. Okay. So yeah, we can talk about this later. So I will just jump to my conclusion. In this presentation, I examine aspects of the Quranic first numbering system and Arabic references in the Quran by Ngarbah, who was the royal servant and Islamic scholar in the early 20th century Javanese Quraton of Surakarta. Clearly mentioned in the front cover of his work, this work was presented to the members of the Wara Dharma literary circle, assuming that the variation in use of references for the compositions of the Quran Jawi reflect the Javanese priest's needs to study Islam and their intellectual interests. So as far as research is concerned, translation or commentary without its original text is a typical feature of the Quranic exegetical activities in the late 19th to the early 20th century Java. So it might be connected to the ways in which the targeted readers wanted to study Quran without necessarily being hindered by the language barrier. Examination of ngarepas Kurang Jawi also shows that the use first numbering is very much different from the mainstream first numbering system in the Muslim world, especially the Kufan system. We negate the possibility of technical errors here that Ngapa or his team might make during its composition based on the reason we wrote in our upcoming articles. Considering the fact that all the translated verses were well presented in Javanese language and script, we assume that Ngarpa developed certain method of the first numbering or adopted certain system that warrant future investigations. Last but not least, Ngarpa's Quran Jawi was composed in the period when modernization started to receive attention from Southeast Asian Muslims. Modernism had encouraged Muslims to approach the Islamic sources more directly. So the complexity in the use of both Arabic commentaries and non-commentary works in the Quran Jawi reflects the way Islamic education had been conducted in the Javanese Keraton milieu. So this is especially the case with the Mambangul Ulum School, where Ngarpa once held the position of headmaster, and with the Waradharma Literary Circle, whom Ngarpa's Javanese Quran was presented. I think that's all my presentation. And sorry, I actually there are more things I don't know than I do, because this year I wrote more than 5 papers on different topics. So as a result, my brain seems to be a little bit disorganized. And hopefully, I would able to push the points of any question that that might come up. One thing for sure, suggestion and feedback from everyone are very much welcome. Thanks for having me in this one wonderful event.
Thank you very much, Arvan, for this interesting and stimulating talk.